as an architect, visualizing not only beautiful buildings, but how they will fit in and enhance our future societies is imperative. Although many people don't think about the psychological impacts of our built environment, the fact is that they have extreme impacts, and though they may be subconscious to many, these impacts are also going to increase rapidly as the Population Reference Bureau predicts over 70% of the world will live in cities by 2050. With this in mind, in addition to the rising sea levels and overpopulation that other classmates have discussed, I believe it is paramount that not just architects, but the general population take part in shaping our future, literally. And while we might not see these effects immediately, I guarantee you that our children will. Architecture is one of the only, if not the only, professions that's roots extend over three millennia. Rem Koolhaas said this in his 2016 AIA speech. So inherently, the profession has gone under many changes, criticisms, appraisals over the centuries. Some even say that the profession will be obsolete in the not-so-distant future and will instead be run by computers. But while it's still a vital profession, I and many others agree that the industry needs to see a change of course, and this could possibly be towards the past. Rem Koolhaas agrees, saying that what architecture offers is memory. To the present is memory, and we as a global community need to exploit this instead of letting major commercialization take over. In addition to this, I think we need to develop more solid design criteria for any architecture that has a public interest. This more thoughtful form of architecture we need to strive for can be achieved in many ways, and it's already being done around the globe, it's not enough. I believe that we need to design buildings that interact more with the history, culture, and surrounding nature of each building, and ensure that every stage of the design is overseen by the architect, client, engineer, but most importantly, the community. Architecture is inherently public. According to Andrew Benjamin, who coined the term opening out as a design philosophy, he believes, like many, that architectural decisions made today are all too often based on economic criteria. While this approach is undeniably better for things like time constraints, Benjamin explains that it fails to allow for the role of architecture to inform part of the nation's community or culture. This is where opening up architecture comes into play, meaning letting the inside out and the outside in. We need to stray from our industrialized and money-driven mindsets if we want to keep producing culture-enhancing architecture by combining architectural knowledge with the nuances of every building site's context. Another concern is modern architecture's functionality. Kate Benefield's article, "Has Architecture Lost Touch with the People?" analyzes the claim that architects are focusing too much on the artistic impacts of their buildings. Architects are even contrasted with the Starbucks franchise, known for their intensive research, customer research, and marketing. Although this is a harsh comparison, it is true that a lot of flashy buildings do seem to lack in function, unlike the ever-bustling Starbucks on every other street corner. But there are a few exemplary counterexamples, as not all civic and commercial architecture is anti-human. One example of this concept is the idea of new urbanism, where you basically use existing architecture and urban developments and reconstruct them for modern purposes. And this kind of combats the idea of sprawl. So there are some precedents out there for us to follow, but we definitely have room to improve. Benfield also references a report from the MIT Department of Urban Studies and Planning, which says the placemaking process has as much benefit for the community building as it does as empowerment for, the placemaking process has as much benefit for community building and empowerment as it does for our public spaces. Not only does community-based design improve spaces and buildings themselves, but it also helps establish a stronger overall community. So designing for the public with the public is what architects should be. Another great example of this is the architect Travis Price, who is also a philosopher and has a background in mythology and ecology. He views today's architecture as soulless, a slow-moving Pompeii, blanking us with the pursuit of loneliness and homogeneity. What he's referring to are things like the stark strip malls you see from the interstate. And what he believes is lacking is an authentic connection with the immediate culture and argues that humans need to escape the fossil fuel buildings we inhabit. An abundance of studies show that living and working closer to nature has a direct physical and mental health benefit, and he claims that there's really almost no difference between the psychology of space and what architects do. And I think that's a very important takeaway. Nowhere does he mention making money or art, just creating healthy and natural spaces. The last example is preservation, where you begin with something that is existing and presumably local, and by adding a new dimension or functionality, this improves the existing architecture. And although this isn't going to cure the problem, it's just one more way we can help. Since none of you are architects, you're probably wondering why I chose to give this speech, and the answer is simply just to raise awareness, and hopefully some of you are inspired to take action. This can be achieved in many ways. This includes supporting ethical engineers and architects, or involving yourself in community-based design, which would be something like voicing your opinion on new developments at a town council meeting, or attending local design charrettes. But most importantly, I want you to all try to appreciate great public spaces and make your friends and family aware of the importance of these things in the future, so that your children don't have to live in tall concrete cubicles in flooding cities. Acknowledgement of nature, history, culture, and preservation are just a few ways we can see the comeback of honest architecture. We need to abolish the notion of architecture as a market economy that perpetuates utilitarian societies. If we do this, I think everyone will realize that good architecture and public spaces are created by involved communities. And designing by these ethics will not only let buildings around us flourish, but also our societies. Thank you.